on February 10th, 2019, at the African American Heritage Museum, the third event of South Jersey Jazz Society's Jazz Legacy Series took place. Guitar legend Teddy Royal performed and answered questions from radio host Ray Tyler.
Ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for the one and only Teddy Royal. Yeah. Okay, Mr. Royal, first of all, it is an honor and pleasure for me to be here today interviewing you. I met you a few weeks ago, so you already have a feel for some of the questions that I'm going to ask you. What were your earliest memories as a musician?
Okay. Well, my first experience as a musician was with a group called the Hearts of Stones. It was the Four Pennies first, and then they became the Hearts of Stones when they hooked up with Motown, when Motown was in Detroit. And it took me out on the road. I was young then. You know, I was about 19, 20. You know,
you're only about 30, 35 now, man.
You serious?
No way.
Okay.
I mean, look at all this gray I got, man.
In the business, we call that experience.
Well, I had a lot of experience with all this hair I got here, gray. But they introduced me to the road. Before they got with Motown, I was like, their personal guitar player.
Okay. How did you get started with the guitar? Was the guitar your first instrument?
My first experience is when I saw this guitar hanging on the bathroom door at my uncle's house.
Okay.
It was on 135th Street, Lenox Avenue.
That's Harlem.
Yeah. I didn't know anything about the guitar then. But when I saw it, it was like, wow. I want to play that. Can I see it? And he took it off because I was a little short guy then. I couldn't reach that high up. And I just fell in love with it. That was my first experience with the guitar.
It seems like the guitar chose you.
Hey, it did.
Okay.
It did.
What type of guitar was it? And what type of musician was your uncle?
He wasn't...
He just had it for show for the ladies.
Yeah, well, I never saw any kind of ladies up in there, you know, but, you know, I was just, you know, I was young then. I didn't know anything about the ladies.
Okay.
You know, I didn't know. I just wanted to play that guitar. And I said, I want to learn how to play that. Can I see it at least? He took it down, gave it to me, and then he took it home. Took it home with me.
Wow.
Yeah, but my mother, she got married twice, okay? She got married twice. And after I had my first experience with that guitar, it wasn't an electric one, it was an acoustic guitar.
Okay.
And my second experience is when I went to my mother's first husband's house. He had a guitar like this, but okay. It was a Kent. And was hanging on the door again.
Again, hanging on the door.
And I said, wow. But it was an electric one. I saw the knobs on it.
Okay. All right.
And I said, can I play it? I didn't know how to play it then. So he says, well, okay. He took it down and I started, you know, just messing with it. I wasn't making any kind of sense with it. You know,
okay.
I was just strumming on it. He says, you want it? I said, yeah. I took it home, and boy, I got on my mother's nerves. I wasn't making any sense. I drove my mother crazy. Sometimes she would hide it from me, but I knew the house was so big, I knew where everything was, you know? So I would play it, but I didn't know my chords. I didn't know anything. I didn't even know how to, you know, make a chord on the guitar at all until I started hanging out on 72nd Street. This bass player, his name was Big Al. He taught me some things. And then the group, the Four Pennies, is when I met them down there. And then that started me off. But my idol was Wes Montgomery.
Wow. Okay. Did you have an opportunity to actually work with him as well?
The closest I got to him was Melvin Ryan.
Okay. All right. Well, absolutely nobody came here to hear me speak. Play something that didn't drive your mother crazy when you had that.
It was this,
those first guitars.
That's what my mother taught me.
Oh, your mother played as well.
She didn't play. She didn't play.
Oh, okay.
She was a seamstress. She sewed. But she was just pick up an instrument. You know? Okay. And she says, play this, Teddy. And that's what I was doing. And it drove her nuts.
After a while. Oh, okay. So the first few hundred times, it was cool.
Yeah, that's okay. As far as I got, man. And then, I started hanging with some musicians,
you know, and
I started getting a little further, you know, because I got tired. I was driving myself crazy because I got tired playing. I said, I want to play something else. I used to watch the Arthur Guthrie show. You remember the Arthur Guthrie show? And I watched the Hawaiian guitar. I didn't know what that was. And I started playing with a butter knife, and it sounded good to me, but I didn't know what I was doing. And I got on my mother's nerves, too, said, shut that world up, you know? And, hey, I guess the slide, you know, those things that you put on your fingers, the slide guitar, you know, they didn't have those then. But, hey, I had fun learning.
Okay. What was one of the first complete songs that you learned?
I didn't know it. Tequila.
Tequila.
That's how I did that.
All right. No, I'm just kidding.
That's it, man. But you know what? My mother would go buy records. Back in the days, they had 45s.
Okay.
You know? And she bought this record called Tequila.
Okay.
You know? And I would, in the living room, the record be playing. Yeah. And I was doing it, you know? That was my first tune that I learned how to play. But I had to learn how to tune my guitar.
Okay.
So my boy taught me how to tune the guitar, you know? So he says, well, you got to know when you go on stage with cats, musicians, man, you got to know your keys. I didn't know my keys.
Okay.
You know? So, yeah.
So you was just up there.
Oh,
freestyling.
Man. Yeah, freestyling. I mean, hey, if you didn't like what I was playing, you didn't have to listen. You know? You know?
They ask you what key, you tell them all of them. I'm going to play all of them.
Well,
I know more bad musician jokes than I should.
When I was with the Hearts of Stones, when I got with them, they wind up with Motown. And then I started making music for their lyrics.
Okay.
And they took me to Motown, and Hank Cosby was their producer. I did a lot of things with them. I went on the road and taught myself a lot of things, and musicians taught me some things too. My first road job, I left New York when I was 19 years old.
Okay.
My first engagement with a famous artist was King Floyd. It made groove.
Okay.
You know, the Suki Suki man. Yeah. I met him in Boston, okay, at the Sugar Shack.
Okay.
Because the group was based out of Providence, Rhode Island. But they were from Tampa, Florida. But one guy, Carl Cutler, was from Philadelphia.
Okay.
So we played at the Uptown Theater in Philadelphia.
Right.
So I left them, and King Floyd sent for me to come to New Orleans.
Oh,
that's where he was from.
Okay.
And that was it for me.
And that was your first trip to New Orleans?
Yes, that was my first trip. But I consider myself from New Orleans because I lived there for 30 years.
Mm-hmm. All right.
I was with Fats Domino for 30 years.
Okay, all right. Going back to the Hearts of Stone, you said that's when you started actually composing and writing music for a group. What was one of your favorite songs or some of your favorite
Lonesome
songs?
Lonesome Road. It's Dan Costone.
Dan Costone. Would you do us the honor of performing a song, please?
Of course I will.
Thank you.
One last question. Yeah. Did you ever have a formal guitar lesson, or was it all strictly pick up and learn on by the seat of your pants?
I'm going to answer that question. Yeah, by the seat of my pants. Hey. You know, I mean, I never went to
I never went to school and had the proper training like a lot of famous musicians, you know, must have been in the same shoes that I was, because couldn't afford the money that you had to pay for lessons, and I'm self-taught.
Okay.
Wes Montgomery was self-taught too. A lot of musicians were self-taught. A lot of musicians didn't know how to read music back then. I'm one of them. You know, I don't feel embarrassed about it, you know, but God gave me an ear, you know, and what I'm doing today is because of him, you know, and it's just a pleasure to be in the African-American Museum to perform, and I thank Jim for having me do this. It's so hard to find someone to believe in you out here in this music business. You know, so, and then to have a great person giving me an interview. So I'm not a very good talker, but I'm gonna play something now. It's called California Nights, yeah?
Thank you.
point in the interview where you're in New Orleans?
There's some heavyweight musicians down there. I mean, I had to fit in, you know. Everything down there, like bigs that I was from up north, I had to slow down. You know, I noticed that they talk slow, eat slow, walk slow, you know, it's like, so I had to adapt. But meeting the musicians down there like James Black, James Booker, Lee Dorsey, Gene Knight, of course King Floyd, Margie Joseph, the Neville Brothers, Aaron Neville's, Charles Neville's, James Rivers, a lot of heavy players, and I got to know them and play with them and learned how to, you know, adapt.
Previous to that, you said you were playing with the group from Motown, the Hearts of Stone. What was the transition like from playing that, which I'm assuming was R&B, to more of authentic blues and jazz?
Okay, well, New Orleans is like jazz, but funk too.
Okay.
A lot of funk down there, because King Floyd was funky. They studied the instruments and they would play it until the next day. There wasn't a time that I wasn't playing.
Right. You know? So I'm going to assume that you may have went from playing maybe a couple hours
it was a big
to playing all day.
Well, it was a big difference because the music was much different than up here.
Right.
Much different. It's just a different type of feeling, a different type of attack, how you play your instrument, and just different. So that's what I'm saying, when I had to learn how to adapt, because I was more or less like Speedy Gonzalez.
Right.
And down there was like, okay, I don't understand what you're, because you're talking too fast.
Okay.
You know, right. That's the best way that I can put it. I got to play with a lot of musicians there and did the Shangri-La show and Mardi Gras. I was on a lot of records. Like, even from here, I'm on Patti LaBelle, Phoenix album. I'm on Alan Toussaint. Alan Toussaint was big down there.
Okay.
Sea Saint Studio, I recorded in with Patti LaBelle, came there, and we recorded when she had the three girls with her. She was by herself after.
Okay.
You know, Joe Tex,
ooh,
James Cotton, the Mighty Diamonds, the Staple Singers.
What was it like recording with Joe Tex? Because his music was so
different,
fierce, and just really in your face.
In your face. Oh, yeah. Well, Joe Tex, he was a very nice person. Like you say, he was always in your face. You know, but the music, his music, he knew what he wanted. Mr. Personality. Do you know who I'm talking
about? Lloyd Price?
Lloyd Price.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah, I met him. Everybody that I'm naming, I'm on their album.
Wow.
You Teddy, can you give us a little demonstration of the syncopation and the style of music that comes from New Orleans and what makes it a little different than what we're used to?
Well, it's funk.
Hey, 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 hey.
you're hearing the Wild Tropicalists and the Double Brothers and all that right there.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, the Wild Magnolias, the Wild Tropicalists. I want both of those albums.
That's a Mardi Gras Indian group.
Yeah, it's Mardi Gras. Yeah.
Okay.
On Bourbon Street, every club down there that you pass, you'll hear music like that. Just like here when you go to work, 9 to 5, that's how it is down there, because they have music from 1 to 2. They leave and then another group of musicians come in every club down there.
That's wonderful. How many years did you play with Fats Domino?
30.
And how did you guys meet, or how did you meet?
From the Strangula show. What happened was, Herbert Hardesty, Fats's saxophone player, he's been with Fats since the 30s.
Okay.
Yeah? He's from Las Vegas. Charles Nevels was the band leader for the Shangri-La show. It's a club down there called the Dewdrop. That's where a lot of famous musicians came, like Duke Ellington, Count Basie, Aretha Franklin. All of them came there and played at this little small club in New Orleans on Louisiana Avenue. So Charles Nevels was doing, it was a play about the Dewdrop, Shangri-La. And Fred Kemp was on it, and he says, hey, man, you sound good. Fats Domino's guitar player, before I got with Fats, okay? Before I got with Fats, his name was Montreal. Fats had two guitar players all the time. The other one was Papoose. Fred said to me, he says, Teddy, won't you let this cat play your guitar? Because I don't like nobody touching it. He's a jazz player. I said, okay, all right. Well, after he got through playing on it, he says to me, Teddy, you want to go to Europe? I've never been there. I says, yeah. He says, you play bass? I says, man, you know I don't play no bass. You see what I play? Guitar. I don't even have a bass. He says, well, you're going to play bass. This was Rod Montreal was telling me this. He says, okay, so he called Fats. I was at the airport, 7 o'clock in the morning. We left. Our first stop was in Munich, Germany. Never been there. I was excited. The whole band came down, and Fats came down. The other guitar player's name was David Douglas. So he says to David Douglas, showing him what to play. So David Douglas couldn't do it. So Fats' brother-in-law, his name was Reggie Hall, and he says, Fats, Teddy play guitar? He wouldn't call me by my name. He would say, boy, you play this, boy? Me with my polite stuff, I said, yes, sir. And I did it. So he says, well, David, you play the bass. And he says, Teddy, you play the guitar. That was that. We went to Europe about 3 times.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah. 1989, 1980, 1981, 82,
83, 84, 85. Okay. Yeah. As I confess to you, it had been a lifelong dream of mine to interview Fats, Mr. Domino, and I never got an opportunity. So this is such a special thrill me to interview you.
Well, I want to tell you something.
So,
staying with Fats, because Fats lived at 1208 Catherine, the Lower Ninth Ward.
Yes.
Big sign up there with his name and stuff. Yellow house, and he had another pink house right on the corner, big as ever. And I stayed with Fats. I stayed in the back room in his mansion. I stayed in his back room. He had all his gold albums up on the wall before Katrina. Every morning he could cook. Oh my gosh. I didn't have to worry about no food or nothing, because he didn't have to worry about it either. Because he had Popeye's chicken in the corner. Then he had Church's chicken across the street. Then he had the A&P back then, right on the corner over there. And then he had the dollar store over here, you know? So, I mean, like, he was surrounded.
He was ready.
He didn't have to go nowhere, you know? And every morning, you know, I would tell you, the best time I had with Fats is when he was in his silk green pajamas. Mm-hmm. And Hanukkah be in this hand and playing the piano with his right hand. And boy, we were going to town.
Man, oh man. What was your mindset as a guitar player? Because when you were working with any prominent musician like that, you really have to like stay in your lane.
Of course, and I did. I stayed in my lane, and I respected him as a musician.
Right.
And I never got out of the way with him, and he never cursed at all. He didn't use vulgar language. But he was a very, very humble person. He was a nice man.
Wow.
He was a very peaceful man. He knew what he wanted. And like you said, stay in your lane. Musicians knew what they had to do. It wasn't of let me shine.
Right.
Or anything like that. You knew what he wanted. And you played what he wanted. And you didn't have no arguments from him.
There you go. There you go. What was your favorite Fats Domino song that you...
I'm Walking? Yes, indeed.
Is it
can I play a little bit of it?
I would be upset if you didn't. That's actually my favorite. That ain't that a shame, but yeah. I'm Walking is beautiful.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Time I heard that song that I didn't sing along. even when I was a tot, the first time I heard it, I just started, you know, I just picked it up. It's a song that I enjoy singing. It just does something to my soul.
That's what New Orleans was about, playing with feeling from your heart. Whatever you feel in your heart, it comes out on your instrument. And, you know, like we're sitting here talking, my instrument is like a conversation.
Right. You know what I'm sorry to cut you off, because this is your interview, but you know what I love about the musical experience like this? We could do an interview here in this space for the next 10 Sundays, and I could ask you to play I'm Walking, but every time it would be a different experience,
right. Right.
And it would mean something different. Yeah. Each time that you played it, yeah. And each time that I heard it, yeah. And each time that the people in the crowd, yeah. heard it. And yeah. I think that's the most beautiful thing about the musical experience, mm-hmm. that sometimes is lost in translation, yes. with recording. But thank God, yeah. we have, yeah. you know, recordings.
Yeah. Well, I'm more good on my instrument than I am with my mouth.
So earlier you talked about the influence of West Montgomery. Yeah. Could you elaborate on that a little bit, please?
Well, I remember the singer, his name was Lindsey Griffin. He's not here anymore. Rest in peace. But when I was playing with the Heart Stones, he said to me, he says, do you know what a good guitar player is? I says, what is it? He says, when a cat can solo and play chords. I said, really? He says, yeah, you want to hear a cat? He says, you ever heard of Wes Montgomery? I says, I've heard of him. He says, I'm going to play some music. And I want you to just really sit down and listen. And every time, you know, we would come from a show with the Hearts of Stones, I would be in the room listening to Wes Montgomery. And there's a tune that I love very much that I like to play for you by him. Yeah. My idol. I remember when I did my first headliner in Camden.
Okay.
Jazz festival. You know, they wanted me to do something like that. And Dan Kostonik, he says to me, he says, you know what, Teddy? He says, Wes Montgomery was in the house.
You know, and I says, you really think I sound like him? He says, yeah, you do. So coming from my big brother, Dan Kostonik, is my organist. Give him a round of applause.
I was just going to say, like, in Philadelphia, everybody calls him East Montgomery.
Yeah, well, I didn't want to say that. Big mouth.
I like that, East Montgomery.
Well, you know who gave me that name? You know who gave me that name? Bootsy Barnes.
Oh, my goodness.
Because he says, hey, your name is East Montgomery. So I stuck with it.
That is beautiful. That's what I'm going to call you now. Hey, other than Mr. Royal. Other than Mr. Royal, I'm going to call you East Montgomery.
Okay,
East Montgomery.
Well,
I like that.
It's cool.
I like that. So you talked about the fact that you recently, well, not recently, but you moved on to become a headliner. Let's talk about your music, because you have a lot of great music
of my
that
own.
You've done yours, yeah, yourself. So,
would you like to hear one of them?
Yes.
Sure.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. But first, I want to say, my manager, her name was Gudrun Francina. She was British in London. She was the one that recorded 3 CDs of me. My first CD was called Morning Groove. She didn't have a record label, and she named the record label Morning Groove. My second CD was called Keep On Moving On. And then my third CD, which was Royal Blue, is what I'm going to play for you now. It has a little blues in it. It has a little jazz in it.
Kind of like yourself.
Yeah.
Kind of like myself. Sometimes I don't even know who I am. But anyway, here it goes. I love you, Jim.
Thank you.
Thank you. Come over and have a glass of wine at our new gallery of it. It's called the Whoopi Goldberg Gallery, and you'll have an opportunity to sign the wall. Whoopi Goldberg donated a painting to the museum for $250,000, and we have it over here, 10 foot by 10 foot. Thank you guys for coming. I want to hear a great song that I heard at Woodstock one time. Can you play any part of that? You know which one I'm talking about.
Which one?
Jimi
Hendrix.
Yeah, whatever you want to do. Oh. Can you give me a little Hendrix?
Give me a little Hendrix.
Wow. Okay.
Boy, you got me on that one.
Okay, that's my job.
Just play something in G.
Okay. Thank you.
much, everyone.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you for coming out.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.